We are rolling. This is it. This is episode 362, Jackie Cation, of No All Laugh right. Track Podcast.
Almost
we are rolling.
1 year
yeah.
of doing these in a row. But
yeah.
many years have gone by.
True. I've often thought of that, like, oh my God, what if someone sat that you, what if you did one a day? What if you sat there and tried to, did it, you know, back to back to back? I mean, these are things that would drive someone insane. No one is ever going to do this. But it's a lot of audio.
Right.
It is a lot of audio. So here we are. We're back. Jackie's back at No Laugh Track Podcast. We're recording on a Friday.
This is it.
You've apparently had a busy week. You've done shows here.
I've done many shows, many radios, many things. So here we are talking. Are we filming as well? Because you got the new film set up.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. That's great. That's glamorous.
Yeah.
Right. That's kind of cool.
I try not to be conscious about it. You're supposed to say we're not recording, then I don't think about it.
Right.
It's broken, right? Already broke? Perfect.
It's does it have Vaseline on the lenses? Is it making us all very good looking? And it softens?
Yes, absolutely. How's the week been going?
It's been going great. It's everybody has enjoyed the shows. I brought a friend of mine to feature for me named Carmen Morales, and she is a delight.
Yeah?
A damn delight.
Have you
guys.
Brought her here before?
No, last year I brought Brandy Posey.
That's right.
Brandy Posey is also a delight, it turns out. Brandy Posey, hilariously, her CD isn't a CD. It's she was selling cassette tapes with a download card. Because most people don't have cassette players, right? I think Carmen just has, because both Brandy and Carmen are headliners, right? They
mm-hmm.
They headline their own shows all the time. And I'm just trying to get them into Acme because they're like, you do Acme? Because Acme's so cool. And I was like, yeah, why don't you come and feature? And people will like you. And it turns out it's worked out.
I think I saw a post from Carmen.
Right.
Who's opening for you, featuring this week. And I think she mentioned this being a bucket list item for her working at Acme. Am I wrong? Did I see that?
Well, I think she's also like 30. So I say, keep filling the bucket, kid. Not that I don't love Acme, but I think some people, it's going windsurfing in Australia or something like that. I don't know.
I'm going to try something new off my bucket list.
The
yes.
bucket list. Right. And we're doing Madison next week, the Comedy on State, which is also on her bucket list. But it's also on my bucket list. So, but my bucket list is slightly more weathered. And
yeah.
It's got a real feel to it.
Yeah.
And, I'm psyched, though, because she's super fun to work with. And the comedy's really smart and funny. So
that's Carmen, someone you met in L.A.?
Yeah. Yeah. She's a Florida comic. And she's a Latino lady.
See?
And she does some joke about how this version doesn't come with the accent.
Oh,
because they've melted essentially.
Right.
It's, right, they've been here longer than my family,
uh-huh,
I think.
Uh-huh,
and
uh-huh.
But yeah, the stuff is smart, and the audiences have been, as per usual, excellent. And I'm working on my new album, so I'm hoping to do it next year sometime. But I need the long sets, you know. I need to work out the chops.
How have you been getting the long sets recently?
Well, this is here's the scoop: is I've been there's been some it's been it's taking a little bit longer than other years other albums because I've gotten fancy featuring work. You know, where Maria Bamford and Brian Regan have to explain that I'm a headliner. And,
you know, as you were saying I'm like, just like Jackie and Maria Bamford and Brian Regan. I was thinking the same thing.
And just like I have to explain that Brandy Posey and Carmen Morales
yes.
are headliners. Because Maria's bringing me on the road
yeah.
to do her sort of theater gigs. And Brian's bringing me on the road to do his stadium gigs. And it's all very fancy. But their sets are only 20, 25 minutes.
Yeah.
So it helps with new stuff. Like, you get to work on a lot of, like, shorter sets. But when you do an album, it's 45 minutes to an hour,
yeah.
right? You got to work on the arc. You have to be able to sustain the whole hour. Even though the radio is only going to play them in tracks of 3 to 4 minutes. So I could put out a 40, I genuinely could put out like a 35, 40 minute album right now and then put out a 35, 40 minute album next year. But,
oh yeah.
Matter of fact, that would probably be more, that would be better money wise because then the stuff could get radio play faster, Sirius XM kind of stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Are you workshopping this right now?
Yes.
Are you going to make a decision? Just made a decision right in front of me.
Announcement. Acme podcast. no, I don't think I'm going to do it though. Because I don't know. There's parts of me that are a bit of a stick in the mud. And so I like the old school, you know. A full album with the kind of arc that I like.
So I have several questions about
okay.
that. One of them is the last album that you did, if I remember correctly.
Hero.
It came out. It was recorded right around the election, correct?
It was 6 weeks after the election. So like Christmas through 2016.
Well, how about 6 weeks after the next one?
Ralph.
That'll be your new thing.
It's
recording after elections, 2020. Come on, Jackie.
Right. Come on to the show and watch me kill myself in real time if there's trouble, you guys. It's like, I don't want to.
You haven't considered this? Come on. It'll be a
right.
new thing for you.
Oh, my God. Think about
the non-political political releases.
Or what do you? It would be if I did kill myself on this stage, just think how much they'd play my stuff on Sirius, and whoever my beneficiaries were, that sound exchange money would be pretty sweet for months. Anyway.
Absolutely.
Or we take back America, you guys. We decide that we don't enjoy white supremacism as convenient as it is.
Could do that too. It's an option.
As a whitey magoo, you would think I would be in favor of white supremacism, but I know too many white people. It turns out, and we're run of the mill.
Yeah,
yeah. Uh-huh. There's it's the same percentage of dum dums as there are when you meet somebody with more melanin.
Very true.
Yeah.
Very
true. Nothing to be done.
I want to ask you my other question about the recording, and that you brought up about the like the 3 minute, the 2 minute, 3 minute, 4 minute things that go out on satellite radio and such. Have you had to do that? Like, we cut down like a 10 minute bit that's been recorded to get it on
the other way
air somewhere.
The other way.
What do you mean? Put them together to make them longer?
Yeah.
Really?
Because somebody was. You didn't hear it from me, and I can't remember who I heard it from. So so the good news is this is gossip that that anyone can deny if it's true.
Sounds
and
great.
Also, I can't get in trouble for it because I can't remember who told me. So I'd be great in the resistance, you guys, because you could torture me, and I'd be like, no, I don't know who told me. I genuinely don't. Anyway, but what I heard was... Sirius XM was being gamed because they pay it's something like $15 a spin. That's the cut if you are the artist.
Oh.
And $15 for the publisher. So $30 a spin. It isn't pennies.
No.
It's boat tons of money, right?
Yeah.
So record labels were cutting super short jokes.
Ah.
So if you have if it's a 45-minute album and you have 40 tracks and you want to play those 40 tracks, so they've instituted, to my knowledge, they've instituted a new rule, whether it's a real rule or if it's just one of those things that you're like, they're not going to play it if it's 1 minute.
Sure.
So I did actually just recut my four other albums into 3 to 5 minute chunks. But
no
I
shit.
Yeah, and I tend to be long-winded anyway. So many of my tracks are already 3 to 6 minutes.
Yeah, yeah.
So I'm a gift to them. If it were squeaky clean, it would help even more because they have a squeaky clean channel.
Yeah, yeah.
And that would be even better.
Could you mix in some more redneck humor to get on that station?
They have a redneck channel too, but the redneck channel, you don't have to be a redneck. You might be a redneck, but you don't have to be a redneck.
Did you just come up with that?
I might have. You guys, okay. Let there be a t-shirt. And yeah, it's super fun though.
Oh, that is catchy.
That is catchy. Get her done, man.
You just did this? Have you noticed a change or is it not
notice? It's too soon. Literally, okay. Because of the deal that I have with my record label, where I own the masters, because I should own the Masters. That's why I own the Masters. Because
it's yours.
They're mine. Mine, yeah. Mine, 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 mine. But because of that, the label doesn't have a vested interest in getting radio play.
Okay, yeah, of course.
You know, they're psyched to, you know, they like me, and they're psyched about my comedy.
Sure.
And they and there is download money that we split. We split download money, but we don't split spin money, like okay. plays. And so there's paperwork that has to be filled out to get it to onto the radio. Sirius XM, even regular radio, actually, stand-up comedy doesn't have the same... ASCAP? What's it called? A BMI?
Yeah, something like that.
Something like that. There's what music does on radio. There's a group that essentially monitors it,
right,
and reports it back for royalties.
Yeah.
There's nothing like that for stand-up. So stand-up can just play on regular analog radio,
oh,
and nobody's checking. So live it up. Regular analog radio.
Yeah.
Play some stand-up.
Less and less people are listening to that radio, too.
Right, right, exactly. But,
the truth, but yeah.
Yeah, and so I did not know why they weren't playing my stuff. I just assumed it was because I didn't give it to them or whatever. I don't know. And then a friend of mine who's at a different label was like, well, did your label fill out the paperwork? And then I told him that I own my Masters, and he was like, he did not. Your label did not fill out the paperwork.
Okay.
But I can give you the paperwork if you want to fill out the paperwork. So I literally filled out this super fiddle and diddle spreadsheet where I had to listen to my albums. I had to put tracks, and then I had to recut some of the tracks to make them longer. And then I had to tag them up. So, and then I had to send suggestions of what channel it
Holy
would work
cow.
On Sirius XM.
You did all the work.
I did all the work. It took about 2 or 3 weeks, because I don't know if you've tried to listen to your own stand-up comedy albums. it's brutal. And you're like, and my first two albums, I burned an album of my own. I did one of those things on the computer, the 90s.
Yeah.
We were all doing it.
Yeah.
And then I put a sticker on it, and there was art, and I put it in a jewel case, and I brought it with me on the road, and it was just gas money, right?
Right.
And they're still available. Sometimes people will send me a picture of them, because they'll find them in, like, a used bin.
Oh,
in
yeah.
But somebody just bought one, and the files had disintegrated off of the CD.
Wow.
Yeah, it was weird. But the buried text message was still there. Anyway, which is just a recipe for baked chicken. Anyway.
Made Are you me serious?
Laugh. Yeah, yeah, yeah. What? It was called Cake Is Not My Downfall.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And but the, so then after that, I did a more reel where I hired an audio guy.
Yeah.
And we put it out. And it was called Circus People.
Yep.
So then the first one who I had done myself, I was like, well, I'm going to redo all those jokes. I still do some of those jokes. And it had been... like 5 or 6 years. And so, but weirdly enough, so It's Never Going to Be Bread is what that one's called.
Yep.
And it's got the Cake Is Not My Downfall bit and a bunch of that material. It also weirdly has some of the material from Circus People, but it's updated and sort of finished,
yep.
Right? So Bread, so I'm listening to these albums going, oh, what a pain in the ass for people having to listen to the first iteration of this L.A. pet joke,
yeah,
and now
yeah.
the second iteration of this L.A. All right. And then I made peace with it.
Yeah,
so
anybody... I mean, that's happened to a million, you know,
right. I mean, you buy albums,
yeah.
right? You buy musical albums, you listen to different versions of the same song.
Yeah.
So
I've heard, yeah, I've heard musicians ask that question a million times. Like, when do you know a song is done?
Oh,
you know,
right.
When do you know a joke is done?
Well, you don't.
Yeah.
Essentially, it's got to be done when you record it. And then if you keep doing it, you're like, oh, look at that tag.
Yeah.
And and then if you put it on another album, you put it on another album.
Yeah.
I think, doesn't Elvis Costello put out different versions of the same music sometimes?
Oh, I don't know. Does he?
I don't know.
Let's say
I would say yes. I would say that a lot of musicians do. So
that makes it difficult to have everything a person releases then.
Oh, right? The Grateful Dead bootleg business.
Oh,
is a
overwhelming
is a strapping industry.
Over,
I don't even know if it's still happening, but I would assume it is.
Let's talk about the other things you've done in the last year. You've done some traveling.
So much traveling.
I want to hear about it.
I think I was I did we had I gone to Vietnam the last time? Vietnam, Cambodia, and Thailand.
Yeah,
I think
sounds,
I might have.
Yes,
I think
yes,
I might have.
Yes.
So this year I've done two European things.
Yeah.
Okay. I did a European tour, Eastern Europe, for the troops, ending in Turkey for as long as I guess that lasts, because the troops aren't allowed off the bases anymore in Eastern Europe and Turkey, because they're gonna, you know, they're at work, right? So if they go into town and people get in their face about American policies, they're supposed to defend America. And we're almost indefensible right now. So we got kids in cages here. People are dying of flu in kennels. So,
By the way, side note, I know someone that snuck back over the border and was in one of those. Enough room for people to lay down. Like, they would fight over spots, the last remaining spots, to have a place to lay down next to the toilet, under the sink, just for a place to sleep.
Yeah. Yeah, we're fucking monsters.
Yeah, real, Jackie. I know it firsthand.
Yeah.
Yeah. Crazy. Well, not firsthand. Secondhand, I guess that would be.
Secondhand. Yeah, secondhand. Secondhand, pardon me. It's brutal.
Yeah.
Yeah. So.
Back to Turkey.
Back to Turkey and Poland and Kosovo and Bulgaria and Romania. So it was just this tour of just the troops being bored. And we didn't really get to see stuff because we're not allowed off the base, you know, because... You drive onto the base, you stay, you perform, and you keep going. But the other trip that, which is more cheerful, is my husband and I saved up and went, we've been saving up for years, to go to France. I've always wanted to go to France, never been to France.
Sure.
And so we went to France for 2 weeks.
First of all, I want to say, why France? Why have you wanted to go for so long?
I studied French in college. I took 5 semesters, passed 3 of them. But I've always, there's a lot of European history in accidental historical fiction reading in my life. So you're like, and there's Roman ruins all over central and southern France. And so we went to Lyon, went to some Roman ruins. Then we drove into the middle of France, to the Ardèche, where there are these cave paintings, 36,000-year-old cave paintings. Werner Herzog did a documentary about it, and Andy had seen the documentary. I did not. I'm willing to see a cave painting. But here's the thing about those cave paintings. You don't actually get to see the cave paintings. They don't want you breathing on 36,000-year-old art. So it's much like, you know, when you go to the Museum of Natural History and you see dinosaurs?
Mm-hmm.
You're not seeing the dinosaur bones.
No, you're seeing a mold or whatever.
Yes,
a cast.
Right, a cast of it. Yeah. And that's what we got to see, essentially reproductions of the...
So less impressive, a little bit.
Right, but always. But, I mean, when I found out about the dinosaurs, I was irritated.
Right.
But the thing is I'm like, well, they're right. I mean, they don't want people breathing on 36,000-year-old paintings.
Oh, yeah.
So we did that. The weird thing about the Ardèche and central France is that's where the French go to vacation. So it's essentially the Wisconsin Dells.
What?
Yeah, it's full on.
Full water slides?
mirrors with yin-yangs and Led Zeppelin on them. I mean, really tchotchke bullshit.
Cool.
That you can full on buy. And you can, you know, there's weed, like a mirror with a big pot leaf on
sure.
it. And you're like.
Spuds McKenzie.
Yeah, some fucking bullshit. So it made me laugh. And then we go to Paris for a week. And we spent, you know, I'm still full of art, and we went in October, so it's December.
Yeah.
So 2 months later, I'm good.
Okay.
For
okay.
museums right now, I don't need to see more paintings, but we saw a lot of paintings. We also went to the French Army Museum, which was the history of World War. It was essentially the Prussian Franco Prussian War of 1870s, World War I, World War II, and. Just heartbreaking and amazing. And then we went to the Resistance Museum, the French Resistance Museum. And also fascinating, we went into a bunker, a World War II bunker that was still there.
Wow.
And we got to see, and it was 200 steps down.
Holy cow.
Like, because they were being bombed. Anyway, so, but get this. So we're in the Ardèche. There's all kinds of tchotchke bullshit.
I was going to say, did you leave with souvenirs?
Well, what I wanted was French Resistance souvenirs.
Uh-huh.
So when we get to the French Resistance Museum, I'm like, hey, I need a... They had enamel pins that they had in World War II.
Okay.
To show that they were in the Resistance, like sort of hidden, like sort of code.
Yeah, yeah.
I was like, hey, money on the table here. I would like some merch. And they're like, no, we do not. That is crass. And I'm like, no, I've been to your crass. I've been to your Wisconsin Dells. You do crass. Don't lie to me and tell me you don't do fucking crass. And by the way, they totally do. I mean, the Eiffel Tower, we bought some like golf tees shaped like the Eiffel Tower. So sure. To hold the golf ball.
Yeah.
But you turn
it is tacky.
Yeah. It turns out tacky's available in different places, but not the French Resistance Museum. And I was like, you guys, I want something cool. So I bought a French Resistance t-shirt, but I bought it on Amazon.
I was going to say, where did was yeah. I thought for sure there was going to be like the people outside, you know.
Knockoffs.
Like, yeah, the knockoffs. Yeah. When there's a concert in town. Yeah.
Yep.
We got Taylor Swift t-shirts, $10,
uh-huh.
40 inside.
Yep.
Yeah, but Minneapolis is spelled wrong.
Yeah. Right. I know. I went and saw Heart. And the Heart t-shirts outside the Hollywood Bowl were $10.
Yeah.
And I was like, I kind of want a Heart t-shirt. But we didn't.
You really need to check the spelling. I've seen misspellings on those t-shirts like that numerous times.
Right. Yeah. And they're all seconds and irregulars, so.
Yeah, know, right.
Yeah,
right.
They don't always fit real well.
It says so. Medium, but there's one really long sleeve and the rest is XL. I don't believe a second of this. I've been catching up on some of your podcasts that you host, like Jackie and Lori.
The Jackie and Lori Show is a mesmerizing tale of two middle-aged women talking about stand-up comedy.
It's seriously, like, it's not 100% for me, yet I really enjoy it.
It isn't 100% for us. It's not 100% for fucking anyone. I don't know. I don't really know who we're doing it for, because a lot of non-comics listen to it. And a lot of women comics listen to it, but a lot of male comics listen to it because we are just talking about stand-up comedy, and women in comedy stuff comes up a fair amount just because people, it is the number one question when you are interviewed for a
10-minute radio segment.
Right,
a
radio segment, an article, and if it's a new interviewer, like I just did a piece for the City Pages here with P.F. Wilson. That guy knows better. Like, we've talked about it. We've discussed what it's like being a woman in comedy,
yeah.
But we did it 12 years ago.
Yeah.
So he doesn't need to still ask me about it. He's good.
Yeah.
And, but if you get someone from The Beast or The Times or, you know, like someone called me up, called my home telephone number and was like, hey, I'm with online thing. And I was like, just wanted to ask you about Louis C.K. on my home phone number. And I was like, why don't you ask a male comic about Louis C.K. and see what Tom Segura thinks about Louis C.K. and stop asking me. Because I don't, you're looking, you want a button push.
Right.
And if you have a better chance of button pushing if you ask Bill Burr.
Yeah.
You have a better, you'll get a better sound bite if you ask Nick Swartzen what he thinks about, you know, just ask somebody.
Yeah, well, who else was on their list when they called you? Sarah Schaefer, who was recently
yeah.
here? They call her too?
Yeah, always.
I bet they did.
Yeah, they always call. It's 1,000 women comics.
Yeah.
And eventually you're just like, well, are we going to ever talk about my projects or my thing? And,
right.
And they're like, oh, sure. And then they never ask about what you're doing or anything. So I've literally stopped answering those questions because I'm like, what do you think I think about it? Anyway, moving right along.
Yeah.
But so the Jackie and Lori Show is where we do talk about all that. We talk about all that bullshit because every couple of weeks there's some new fresh horror
yeah.
in life, of course, and then also in comedy. And like today, some comic, there's a comedy online presence. Supposedly comedy, called the Young Turks.
Okay.
And first of all, they're Turkish, and they've named themselves after the government that created the Armenian genocide that was responsible for killing 1.5 million Armenians, and they're Turkish. And I was like, okay, this isn't a euphemism. You genuinely hate Armenian people, and I can't support you.
No.
But the thing is I thought it was a joke, so I was on the Young Turks channel once, probably a dozen years ago. And so this guy, he's sort of like one of the, he's like a fake socialist. Like, he's raking in the money with both hands. And he's genuinely, like not woke. He is, he's a big guy for, he's an ass grabbing kind of douche, right? So he is running for Congress.
Okay.
In California. Comedy guy with this weird dirtbag ancestry, you know, this bro-y, dude bro-y kind of following is running for Congress against a working Democrat. And Bernie Sanders had just advocated for him, is just backed him up. And I was like, oh, there's all kinds of trouble there. There's trouble comedy-wise. There's trouble politically. There's trouble dude-wise. There's trouble lady-wise. Fuck me. And so I'm sure we will discuss this in the next episode of the Jackie and Lori Show, which we're not taping until the 22nd. So because we just did a couple of live episodes.
Yeah, I listened to those.
Oh, did you listen to the last one? Mm-hmm. Or the first one? It was Bend.
I heard that one. I heard Bend. Yeah, definitely heard Bend, and I heard a second
Stand,
one.
The New York one? Maybe? We were in New York City at the Stand?
Yeah.
Yeah, that was super fun, too. Uh-huh. Yeah. And the live ones are fun. Lori loves it because she doesn't... She is like everyone, right? You love a live audience. And so Kyle, the guy who does our audio, he's an excellent laugher.
Yes, he is.
And a very funny comic, Kyle Clark. He sometimes isn't enough. Like, if we just record it, it's just the two of us, and I don't laugh enough at her jokes. She's like, let's do live ones. But here's the weird thing about doing live ones.
Yeah, yeah.
So we do live shows, and then she doesn't think it's real entertainment. I mean, you know how we're here in front of nobody, except for, of course, Brandon.
Yeah. I heard him laugh once.
He laughed once. but if we did this live, it would be much more gratifying, right?
Because
there would be audience interaction. So the live ones... Lori doesn't think that it's entertainment, so she's wrong.
Yeah.
It is, because people listen to podcasts for entertainment.
Yeah.
And information and whatever other reasons, but so we always do stand-up as well. So we each do a half hour, and then we do an hour podcast.
Oh.
Yeah. But we don't air the stand-up.
Yeah, yeah, okay.
Because it's usually new stuff that we're working on. So, but like the Live Dork Forests, I never had a problem. Just doing live work for us. Though, I do like the idea of doing stand-up as well, because I love stand-up. Why wouldn't I?
Why wouldn't you?
And then I'd get to dork out with somebody for an hour or two, which is also super fun for me.
I have to point out, and I still love it, that you guys are like looking at the clock.
Oh my God, the clock thing is hilarious. Where you're like, I'm sure we're at an hour. This has got to be an hour, right? Someone wanted a t-shirt that said some variation on that.
Yeah.
And we have... Speaking of merch, the Jackie and Lori merch is always, she wanted tote bags, but let me tell you something about the hippie grocery bag industry. It's saturated. There's a lot of hippie, and they're a dollar.
Jackie, earlier this week, I was doing some cleaning at home. I have so many of those recyclable groceries.
Yeah.
I found like a dozen of them. I thought we had two.
Right.
There are at least 12 in my pantry.
Exactly. Because you run out of bags, and you're like, well, I probably shouldn't get a plastic bag that I'll throw away. I'll buy another one of these that I will eventually throw away.
Yeah, so many.
Yeah, it is. Matter of fact, we should just take them and just leave them outside a grocery store so that people can just take them as they walk in.
No, collect deposit.
Yeah, it's a nickel. And
so you have Jackie and Lori totes?
Yeah, we have Jackie and Lori tote bags. And then, but we did just make a really cool, it's super cool, super heavy. Our merch decisions are not great. Notebooks.
Okay.
They're beautiful notebooks.
I saw them.
Yeah.
Online.
They just have our logo on the cover, and then, but they're pop colors, so there's a little strap, and the side of the paper, it's lined paper on the inside.
Yeah.
But the sides of the paper are colors, different colors. And they're, you know, blue and red and orange and yellow and pink, maybe not yellow, whatever. But we have to, they're 11 ounces each.
Mm-hmm.
So to mail someone, and they were a fortune, they cost $12 each. So we're selling them for $20 live.
Okay.
But if you want to order them online from JackieandLori@gmail.com, they're $30 because it costs $5 or $7 to mail them.
Uh-huh. Oh, yeah.
So
you have a crate of them here is what you're saying? And you demand people buy them.
We have 200 of them, and I did not bring them because they're super heavy.
Right.
But then for me, Jackie Cation, I have a bunch of new merch.
Yeah.
Because I've... I like I don't like selling t-shirts. Like, some comics, they have one t-shirt, they sell it. It's just, you know, my favorite story, Jake Johansson has a t-shirt that just says, touch it. Well, it's a terrible t-shirt. Fuck you. And I saw it, and I said to Jake Johansson, what is happening? You're better than this. And he looked at me right in the face, and he goes, I have a mortgage. Leave me alone.
Ah!
And
he also is selling a t-shirt now, because I brought one home,
okay,
that just says sex robot. And he even, I think, I don't remember if it's on stage or if he said it to me.
He has to have paid off his house so far.
Right, right. I know. What does somebody need a...
what, somebody need braces? What's happening?
He told me that someone wears the t-shirt sex robot, it leads to sex. And I have to say, he's not wrong.
Were you alone? Because it can always lead to alone
he's
sex.
Not wrong.
Huh?
My wife was wearing it, and it led to.
It led right there.
Yep.
Right there. Where uh-huh. We did it.
Thank you, Jake.
Thank you, Jake, for getting me some action.
That's right. Sex robot. It works.
Sex robot. Hilarious.
So how many do you have with you here at
Acme? Only brought the one new one.
Okay.
Because here's the thing. I have Dork Forest t-shirts, and I'm going to phase out. I was going to phase out the green one because I was going to make a new black
classic
t-shirt. But I'm keeping the green one. Now, I was gonna put it on black. I have two t-shirts. I have a Ranger of the Dork Forest t-shirt, which is a lot of dorky things coming out of the forest.
Yeah.
Says Ranger of the Dork Forest. Adorable. I have the logo, the Dork Forest logo, which has like a D12 on it and the Rebel Alliance symbol without the benefit of copyright. And it has a line in Elvish that means I found it. It's what Aragorn says when he finds the White Tree at the end of Lord of the Rings. Anyway, that's on green. So the Black Ranger, the green logo shirt. And then I have two other t-shirts. One, Spooky Reading Girl t-shirt on purple, and a royal blue Meat Shield t-shirt. The Meat Shield t-shirt and the Meat Shield enamel pin are charity items. And I'm almost at 10 grand. I've donated $9,000 to 1,000 different, to like the ACLU, Black Lives Matter, Southern Law Poverty Thing, Racist Texas, Immigrant Defense, because of the dumpster fire that is our country. So, but I'm real close to that next 1,000. I did give 1,000 to something called a Minneapolis company called Resisting Sisterhood.
Okay.
And it helps Muslim women who need to sort of relocate in Minneapolis, finding jobs. And because sometimes the community is supportive and sometimes it is not.
Sure.
And so it's super helpful for women, sort of the domestic violence kind of thing. And so, yeah. Anyway, so I have a new 1,000. And that new 1,000, I've decided, is going to go to make sure that people who get out of jail register to vote.
Okay.
Yeah. So, you know, gets them ID and... it's called a Vote for Change or something like that. It's pretty great.
Yeah.
Anyway, so that's the Meat Shield. So I have a blue one, Meat Shield. I have a purple one, Spooky. I have a green one, Dork Forest. And I have a black one, Ranger of the Dork Forest. I am discontinuing the black one, Ranger of the Dork Forest. Going to keep the green one, the Dork Forest logo. Going to lose the Spooky.
Oh my
Spooky
goodness.
Reading Girl, that's done. Just gonna do pins or never anything, because it's the joke 6 years old.
Sure.
I'm over it. And then the Meat Shield t-shirt, I'm thinking of phasing out the t-shirts and just going with the pins. So I have with me a gray t-shirt that has an image of the brawny paper towel guy, the Swiss Miss Lady, and a gummy bear all hugging.
Oh, I saw this.
Yes.
Yes.
And that is the new t-shirt. All my t-shirts are union made. And then one that is...
Well, what are you going to... Do you want to see what it says on that one?
No, you should come and see.
Okay.
But then the other one, I could tell you about the other one, which is being printed right now, is gold.
Oh.
And it's essentially, it's a drawing of my father with all of his sayings.
No way.
Yeah. So never say no without a number. There'll always be more money because there has to be.
Creativity is more important than following the rules.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he doesn't.
What is this one? The bee goes from flower to flower.
The flower doesn't go from bee to bee.
What?
That was his sex talk. That was the
what?
That was the one sex talk
no.
that he gave me. Which guess which one you are? He said
no,
the bee
no.
goes from flower to flower.
No.
The flower doesn't go from bee to bee. Guess which one you are? Yeah,
no.
We live in a dystopian present. I do like give yourself awards. No one checks.
That's awesome.
He He's like, didn't you win the best European stand-up comic or stand-up comic of the year in Vietnam last year?
Yeah,
and
yeah.
I was
born
like,
in...
stop talking,
this
Dad.
This tall? Yeah.
I love you. Anyway.
And he's still going strong?
So he's... Well, he was a couple of weeks ago, and I called him, and he was like, I'm sleeping too much. Oh. I think I'm dying.
Oh, no.
And he's 84.
Yeah.
So I was like, well, don't die before I get there. I get there on Sunday. I'm going to be there Sunday through Wednesday.
Okay.
Because I finish here. I have two shows, of course, tonight and tomorrow. And then Sunday, I drive to Milwaukee to see the family. And then on Thursday, I go to Madison, Wisconsin to do comedy on state through the weekend. So... should be fun.
For sure.
Yeah.
I think I've done this with you before, probably. I like looking up stories from people's like hometown.
Oh, yeah.
Like a news story.
Did you look up South Milwaukee?
Of course I did.
Ha!
Do you have any idea what the biggest story recently from South Milwaukee?
Is it the Crusher?
Yes!
Yeah.
But why? But what part of that?
Well, they put a statue up. I have a picture.
I saw
of myself
that.
With the Crusher.
So, I found this story that I'm about to tell you about.
Okay.
And then, in strange order, then saw your picture next to the statue.
Of the Crusher.
So there's a statue.
Nothing happens in South Milwaukee. This thing is the hugest thing that's happened in a generation.
It's a statue to a, professional wrestler.
Former
yes. professional mm-hmm. wrestler from the area, correct?
Yes.
Yes.
I think Baron von Raschke is from Minnesota.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. So many. Who brought you to the statue? Was it like, well, we're going to go?
No, I went.
Or were you just walking by? And
no,
like,
no,
oh,
it was a destination.
It was a destination.
Well, South Milwaukee is the size of this building. So, granted, it's got 20,000 people in it, the town, and it's more of a bedroom community now. It's like a suburb than its own town, but it is its own town. And when I grew up there, the main street, which is where the big factory is, it was a Caterpillar factory, I think it's closing, but the statue's right across from that at the old train station, and it's essentially the Crusher holding a quarter barrel like a keg,
yeah.
on his shoulder, and I remember in high school people were like, we're getting a quarter barrel, you want to come over, and I was like, no, I don't. Weird.
And that was like on a Tuesday.
Yeah. Yeah.
During the school week.
And I was 14. So.
Okay. So this story that I have is about that statue. But did you hear about this? An 18-year-old South Milwaukee man has been convicted of vandalizing the Crusher statue. And he has now been sentenced.
Oh, really?
Yes. But here's what happened. The kid's name is James C. Dudgeon, D-U-D-G-E-O-N. Do you know that last name?
No.
Dudgeon?
Okay.
Okay. In any case, James, we'll just call him James. James, they issued a sentence for James at a joint police sentencing about a week ago. The second time this year the teenager has faced prison time for a crime. In the most recent case, James, he threw a concrete block at the 600-pound life-size statue of South Milwaukee wrestling icon Reggie Lisowski.
Reggie Lisowski.
Lisowski.
Sure.
Why did he do it, Jackie? Quote, he did it to be cool.
Well, how old is he?
18.
Yeah. It's there's literally nothing to do in South Milwaukee.
He thought he'd do it to be cool, and because he thought he would be, quote, a tough guy. When he was out with friends in this past August, of course, we know the Crusher was known for his 40-year professional wrestling career. He died in 2005.
And beating his wife. He was also known for that.
Oh.
Yeah.
So when are we going to tear down this statue then? That's not going to happen
too,
in 20 years?
I think we've made, he's dead.
We're not going back?
No, we're not going back.
Okay.
We're just, Bing Crosby used to beat his wife too. We're not, not watching Holiday Inn. There's other reasons not to watch Holiday Inn. Anyway,
the statue, which features Lisowski carrying a beer barrel over his shoulder, was unveiled during a 2-day festival in June called...
Crusher Fest. That's right.
Of course, it's called Crusher Fest. Did you know the community raised more than $40,000 for the construction of that statue?
I know that I was asked to donate to it, and I did not.
As a celebrity, you were asked to donate, or as a former resident?
As a former resident.
Okay.
Though I did get a very nice, I did have lunch with the mayor once because I was a celebrity.
Look at that.
The mayor of South Milwaukee, who has a day job.
Ah! pays that well, huh?
Well, there's that much to do.
There's that much going on. Okay, that makes sense. This says here it stands at 11th and Milwaukee Avenues in South Milwaukee. Mm-hmm. 2 months after the statue was unveiled, the Crusher's family discovered it was vandalized, and they had video surveillance, and they found this kid.
Right. Well, there's a camera up because of course it's going to be vandalized. And I saw the video and I was like, oh yeah, of course.
Yeah.
Because they're like packs of dogs. Like all you do when you live in South Milwaukee is wander the streets because you don't want to go home.
Sure.
Because you're 15.
Right.
And nobody wants to go home when you're 15. Right. And now luckily kids have phones now so they can lean against things and stare into their phones.
Very true. Yeah. Very true. We all should go into, I need to tell my kids to go in to be doctors for bad backs and necks. Everybody looking at their phones, honestly.
Oh, yeah.
The restitution, by the way, he's ordered to pay $650 in restitution to the Crusher Foundation, and he has to send an apology to the foundation.
Well, what, did it actually hurt the statue?
Yeah. He admitted his involvement. He had to pay for the damage.
What was the damage?
$1,200.
But what did, I mean,
he threw a brick at it.
A cinder block brick at it.
Yeah.
So, but I mean, the thing is made out of bronze. I mean, I just saw the Rodin.
Oh,
like
here we go.
The Thinker.
Yeah.
It was also made out of bronze. Almost vandal-proof.
Vandal-proof, okay.
Yeah.
Video surveillance showed two men repeatedly striking the statue with a concrete block, damaging its nose, right cheek, and upper right chest.
Okay.
So.
Oh, just sort of like just try to chip it?
Yeah, they're trying
or something?
To beat the hell out of it.
Or just maybe scratched it up.
Yeah.
Try to knock the nose off of it or in a Sphinx-like moment.
I guess. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
By the way, I'm going to be kicking myself if I don't mention this. We were talking about earlier about, like, you know, people can't keep their hands off things at art museums and so or the dinosaurs and stuff.
Oh, yeah,
you're looking at the replica. About a week or so ago, we had a Titanic documentary on at home.
Okay.
And I'm going to bust my mother-in-law for this.
Oh.
And she's like, oh, have you guys seen the traveling Titanic exhibit? I was like, yeah, we saw it. It was in Vegas when we were there last year.
Yep.
We actually did see it. And she goes, oh, yeah, we saw it about a dozen years ago when it was here in St. Paul. And they have this big piece from the hull or something that they pulled up. And she's like, they have it behind ropes and they tell you not to touch it. She's like, I chipped off a piece of paint. I was like, what? No!
What are you doing?
No, no, no!
Okay.
No!
But classic, though, because when I took Latin in high school, I was, my Latin teacher, she was like, when you go and see the ruins, you have to leave the stuff there. It just looks like rocks. They're not. They're ruins. It's a different thing.
Yeah.
If everybody took a rock from the Parthenon, there would be no more Parthenon.
Yeah.
So leave it.
Mm-hmm.
And it was so funny. We were, but like, there's definitely, like, what I was at the Delphi Oracle at Delphi. I was at some sort of in Greece. I was at something in Greece, and it was we climbed over the fence because there was no security guard.
Okay.
And so we brought a bottle of wine. It's 1989, 1,000 years ago. I'm with two guys, a South African guy, a Canadian guy, and a woman from Mexico, Mexican woman. So we all, four of us, go in. We have a bottle of wine. We were going to hang out. And we go stand on the altar. And the Canadian, of course, hilarious. This is almost a caricature because he's like, hey, I'm reading. There's a sign here that says, don't stand on the altar. And the Mexican woman is trying to, she's brought a candle and she wants to light a candle. And so she's moving some of the rocks around. And I go, hey, it's not a construction site. You don't get to move the rocks around. She's like, oh, good point. And so we just essentially wandered around looking for like some sort of ancient, you know, sort of goddess kind of
right.
energy that we were looking for. We didn't find it. We were just, we were essentially just assholes.
Yeah.
And
how was the wine?
The wine was lovely.
That's good. That's good.
Cheap. Because we were all 20.
Yeah.
So,
did you ever go to the, what is it called? Crystal Cave or whatever it's called?
Where is it?
It's the place where you go way down, and it's got the stalagmites and the stalactites. It's just popped into my memory. That was a whole other thing where they're like, whatever you do not touch these things. They've been forming for thousands or millions a year, or whatever. And but they also tell you it's darker down here. It's 1,000 times darker than anything you'll ever, on the surface of the earth. It'll never get this dark because you're down there. So as soon as you get there, like, touch. Like, terrible. Hands to yourself, people.
Yeah. Just to try not to to take history home with you.
Yes. Yeah, right. Don't take history home.
When you're in a national park, you're not even supposed to take pine cones and stuff.
Really?
Yeah, which is weird, because you're like, there'll be more pine cones.
Sure.
But maybe if everybody took pine cones, there wouldn't be enough pine cones. I don't know. There's 8 billion people on the planet. There's a lot of people.
Disney Plus.
I have it.
Tell me.
Mandalorian.
Love it?
Yep.
Like it?
Yep.
Yep.
It's
all 5, 6? How many are out now? 5?
5. I've seen 5.
You have. I'm through 4.
You're through 4. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I love the music. The music is really cool, and it's turning into more and more of a Western, and it's super cool. And I liked, was it Amy Sedaris? Was in?
See, I haven't watched the fifth one, but I saw spoiler alert. I saw the pictures on social media.
Fair enough. Yeah, and I didn't realize it was her until after, and I was like, oh, she was awesome.
Oh, you didn't recognize her?
No, I never recognize anybody though. So
I want that skill.
It's
I hate being distracted by that with voices and cartoons.
Oh, really?
Like, yeah, I don't like that. I would love to not connect the dots with that. I really would.
So what did I see? I saw The Long Shot, the Seth Rogen, Charlize Theron romantic comedy where she's Secretary of State.
Kurt Braunohler's in that.
Yes. Yeah. Yes, which the first time I saw it was on the back of a chair. And so the fourth time I saw it was on my television.
Okay, I've never seen it.
Because it's adorable. And I was like, that's Kurt Braunohler. Anyway, so, it's Charlize Theron. And I also own Mad Max Fury Road. And I did not know it was the same person.
Wow.
I never know who anybody is. Have you seen the Tig Notaro? There's a web series on YouTube called Under a Rock.
No.
And it's
heard
famous
about it.
People come on, and she doesn't know who they are.
Yes.
Which is essentially, I could have had that show.
Yeah.
But I guess she did Tony Shalhoub.
Just recently, within the last week or something,
maybe,
right?
Yeah. I don't know. But so Tony Shalhoub shows up on set, and she's like, it's very nice to meet you. And he sits down, and he's like, you have no idea who I am? And she's like, no, I'm so sorry. And I would know who Tony Shalhoub was, but there's thousands. I mean, there's so many famous people.
I saw this morning Danny Aiello passed away. Do you know who that is?
I know that name.
You know the name.
What is he? Who is he?
What is he? Well, he was an actor.
Yes.
He remember the Papa Don't Preach video, Madonna?
No.
Yes, you do. This is me talking to my wife. Do you remember the... No.
No.
You do know.
You do know. If I saw
Damn it, you
it,
know.
Yes, I would see it. He was in it?
He played her father in the Papa Don't Preach video.
Okay.
He
All
was
right.
in some Spike
movies.
Lee movies.
Okay. Was he in...
He was in that terrible...
Was he the pizza guy owner in his Do the Right Thing?
Yes. I believe so.
Okay.
He is in Do the Right Thing. Brandon, you can't back me up on this? Yeah, he doesn't know. Sure, he doesn't.
Fair enough.
He was in the movie Hudson Hawk that you had to have watched that awful movie at least once.
Well, I never had cable because the thing about Hudson Hawk is that was like Beastmaster. It was on a rotation on cable nonstop, like Shawshank Redemption.
Sure.
Right? Like they played Hudson Hawk 1,000 times a day.
Well, I saw Hudson Hawk in the movie theater because no one warned me about how bad it was going to be. So, and he's in that. So anyway,
so
Danny
he just passed away.
Yes, yeah, today.
How old was he?
88. I'm going to say
not
if
a career
my memory.
Cut tragically short.
No.
So there you go.
Yeah. I couldn't tell you much more about him.
Mm-hmm.
Where's the time here? We could put a bow on this thing. Is there anything else we should be mentioning? You got the merch. You got
1,000 pounds of merch.
1,000 pounds of merch.
And
cash only.
No, I got a square.
You take cards.
What am I? A Luddite? I have a square. But the new material, I'm pretty proud of the new material. I'll say that, is that some of it's you know, some of it needs work, but premise-wise, and there's a lot of good punchlines, I just need to tighten it all up. Like, I have a good 30, 35 that's done for the album.
Okay.
But I want another 20, you know? I want it to be 45 to 55 minutes. Because even though musicians, they put out a new album at 35, yeah. 30, 35. Comics, it's usually 45 to an hour. So, plus, I'm tempted to, I'm supposed to submit video to Netflix and Comedy Central and HBO so that they could see the hour and see if that there's, if would they want to give me a special?
Oh.
And we'll see if, and so I'm going to record with the new setup here.
Yeah.
And then
look at all these cameras.
Look at all these cameras, and then I'll send it to somebody who cares, and hopefully...
I listened back to when we did this a year ago, and that was one of the things that we talked about, was that list, like, here's the people that should get a Netflix special.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm still on that list. But, you know, it turns out you also have to be proactive. They would like a sample of what that would be,
yeah.
Unless you're famous, or somebody famous backs you up, right?
Sure.
Like, They Ready, the Tiffany Haddish, because
Tracy Ashley.
Yeah, Minneapolis comic.
Oh, yeah.
And Felicia Michaels and Ada Rodriguez. They're all three of those. And there's two others that I don't know those two women. But okay. Those three women, I know those three women well, and they're all genuinely funny. So if you get a chance to see They Ready Half yes. Hours, Tracy Ashley's a freaking delight.
Oh, yeah.
And then Ada Rodriguez and Felicia Michaels, awesome. Awesome stand-ups.
Tracy Ashley, by the way, also a writer for that TV show, The Neighborhood, that was on the other night. And my wife was like, why is this on? I said, because Tracy Ashley writes for the show and we know her. That's
right.
Why.
You got to watch.
Damn right.
Give it a shot. I watched that murder show on HBO, Barry.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, because my friend Emily Heller writes for it, was a producer, you know.
Oh, she does?
Yeah, she's a big deal. And I was like, okay. And it's very funny. Too dark.
Okay.
Too dark for Jackie Succession. Oh. Jackie Succession doesn't want any part of it. All scary.
Yeah.
And I was like, this guy's, it's not going to get any better. And it's always, it's like Breaking Bad. When his girlfriend died, I was like, oh, I'm done watching this. That was my chance. I thought there was going to be redemption. There's not going to be any redemption in Breaking Bad. I've never seen The Godfather 2 because of the end of The Godfather. I was like, oh, this isn't going to work out. This is terrible people. This is terrible people being terrible. The Wire, saddest show on television. Incredibly well acted,
yeah.
Well written, well directed, beautifully shot. Want no part of it. Watch the first season. Don't need to see anymore.
Oh, you didn't see once they added Danny Aiello.
Oh, there you go. Huh? Come on. And Charlize Theron.
And Charlize Theron. Yeah, exactly. Unrecognizable. Jackie, it's been great. Coffee's empty. It's time to get a refill.
Exactly. Now's the time.
Yep. Thank you.